All right. Well, I'd like to thank my wife and my three daughters up there for providing that music. It was a lovely song, and we're appreciating that. I would ask you, if you will, please, to open up your Bibles to the book of Revelation and the fourth chapter, please. Chapter 4 of Revelation. You know, one of the great dangers that you face in a humanistic age is that all the lines of thought that people engage in, well, they're all man-centered. They begin with their own perspective on everything, and the culture that they live in reinforces that kind of thing. And so men, they sort of fall into an ignorance about God. They can't see anything from a real biblical or scriptural perspective. And it's a sad thing, and we want to do something about it here this morning. We're actually going to be studying a little bit about God, about what God actually is like. And I found a passage that we can get into here in Revelation chapter 4. There's only 11 verses in the chapter, so let's go ahead and read that chapter here together. Revelation chapter 4, we read, "And after this I looked, and behold, a door was opened in heaven, and the first voice which I heard was as it were of a trumpet talking with me, which said, Come up hither, and I will show thee things which must be hereafter. And immediately I was in the Spirit, and behold, a throne was set in heaven, and one sat on the throne. And he that sat was to look upon like a jasper and a sardine stone. And there was a rainbow round about the throne in sight like unto an emerald. And round about the throne were 24 seats. And upon the seats I saw 24 elders sitting, clothed in white raiment, and they had on their heads crowns of gold. And out of the throne proceeded lightnings and thunders and voices. And there were 7 lamps of fire burning before the throne, which are the 7 spirits of God. And before their throne there was a sea of glass like unto crystal. And in the midst of the throne and round about the throne there were 4 beasts full of eyes before and behind. And the first beast was like a lion, and the second beast like a calf. And the third beast had a face as of a man. And the fourth beast was like a flying eagle. And the 4 beasts had each of them 6 wings about him, and they were full of eyes within, and they rest not day and night, saying, Holy, 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 Lord God Almighty, which was and is to come. And when those beasts give glory and honor and thanks to him that sat on the throne, who liveth forever and ever, the 24 elders, they fall down before him that sat on the throne, and they worship him that liveth forever and ever, and cast their crowns before the throne, saying, Thou art worthy, O Lord, to receive glory and honor and power, for thou hast created all things, and for thy pleasure they are and were created. Now, I want us to go ahead and look at verse number 8. We see in that particular verse there that we're in the very throne room of God up on heaven, on high. And there are described there 4 beasts. Some say that they are seraphim. Some say they are cherubim. In Ezekiel, there's some similar beasts are described as living creatures. But whatever they are part of the praise that surrounds the throne of God. And they're awesome. And, you know, they could obviously give us a very intelligent and qualified explanation as to what God is like in his essential being, for they stand in his very presence. And I want you to notice what these 4 beings say. And it comes out as something that we would see it as a characteristic expression, maybe even a song, something that they say repeatedly. And we have their words there at the end of verse 8. They say, Holy, 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 Lord God Almighty, which was and is and is to come, the Almighty. Now, listen, that the first word out of their mouth is holy. Holy is an attribute of God. As a matter of fact, holiness, God's holiness, is almost like an attribute of attributes because it talks so many things about God. And notice that they triple that. That's for emphasis. I believe in part it does refer to the fact that they are praising God the Trinity, God the Father, God the Son, God the Holy Spirit, the thrice holy Godhead, but also in repeating that particular attribute, holy, again and again, they are emphasizing just how vital and important it is if you were to understand what God is like. As a matter of fact, what holiness really is, we call it an attribute. It's lined up with the attributes, but it's something more. It is God's essential nature. It describes his character. You know, and in God's case, holiness, his holiness, it's not determined by what he does, but rather by what he is. And to be holy, God, he doesn't try to conform himself to some standard that he has in mind. As a matter of fact, God is he is the standard. And how he acts naturally, how he behaves necessarily, that provides a standard of holiness for everything that he does and for all that he makes, including those rational creatures. Not that any creature could compare in holiness to God, but nevertheless, when God has a moral stance on anything, he's perfect. And when we talk about holiness as connected to God, it's like everything about God is holy. I mean, his name is holy, his word, his works, his law, his spirit, his angels. There's nothing about God that isn't holy. And he refers to himself. That's one of the things when he's describing himself. I think it's over 30 times in the book, in the Old Testament, he calls himself the Holy One of Israel. Sometimes he calls himself the Holy One of Jacob. But when he went to swear to David that he would, of David's posterity, of his seed, raise up one to sit upon the throne, you know, he said, I swear by my holiness. It's almost as if God, he were looking things over. He says, you want assurance? I'll give you assurance. I'll take my oath before you. And because there's nothing that means any more to me, nothing more important about me than my holiness, I'll put that out as if pawn. If you would go ahead and receive full assurance that what I have said, David, as I have promised, so I will perform it to you. I swear by my own holiness. And of course, we know what David did. He appointed singers to go even before his soldiers. And what they did, they were there to praise the beauty of holiness. This is really a very key and vital idea. If we are to understand something about God, and we live in a generation, they just don't understand God. Like I said at the beginning, we live in a generation to become, man is the measure of all things now. You watch any news report on television, and what you find is a human perspective. You watch any movie, read any book or novel, you find that it's always man that is glorified, never God. And so this morning, we want to learn a few things about God, and we're going to concentrate on this very basic and necessary idea that God is holy. And what does that mean? What does it mean for him to be holy? And what does that mean for us? I just have a few things I'd like to share with you here this morning. And number one, let me just say this, that the holiness of God, it refers to his complete separation, or I might call that his complete set apartness from everything that defiles, from all sin, including sin as it would exist within creatures who may have originally been made in a state of innocence and able to fellowship with God, even as Adam, our first forefather, was. But now we see that God dwells up in the third heaven. We dwell on earth. There is a separation. You know, because he is perfect in holiness, creatures such as you and I, we just can't waltz into his presence like those cherubim and seraphim. Because God is perfect in holiness. And what does that mean? Well, it means a couple of things. It means, first of all, he's utterly pure. There is no admixture of anything that would taint his purity. He's perfectly good. Matter of fact, John says this, that John in his first epistle, he says, God is light, and in him is no darkness at all. He says, you know, there's not a single particle of darkness that's mixed in with God. If you were to look him, you would see that our God is not only a consuming fire, but our God is such because he is aflame with holiness, a holiness that has no tarnish to it whatsoever. And God is perfectly righteous. That's another thing. He cannot do a wrong thing. And those two words, holiness and righteousness, really they mark two aspects of one condition. Holiness has to do with character and righteousness with conduct. And they cannot possibly be separated one from the other. They are as intimately related as are the root and the fruit. Well, the root is the fact that he is holy, and righteousness comes to pass because of that. That's the fruit. Holiness describes God's being, what he is. Righteousness describes his doing, how he acts necessarily out of the being that he is. And, you know, we say of Jesus Christ, he was the only begotten Son of God, and we say that he was born, he was impeccable, is the word theologians choose to describe Jesus Christ by. And when they say impeccable, that means you look him over from every direction. There's not a fault that can be found in him. There's no blemish. There's nothing wrong. He can be described as immaculate, meaning there is absolutely no pollution or anything that would, be a contaminant. Or if you want to put it in a single word, that word would be holy. I like what Saint Anselm said back in the Middle Ages. He was talking about God, and he was trying to give some just understanding to men. What is God like? And he said, you know what? We need to think of God like this, that God is a being than which none greater can possibly be conceived. God occupies a high place of perfection. He, unlike us, he can't really change. He's because he is a being than which none greater can be conceived. He's not susceptible to change. We call that he's immutable. You and I are not. Why? Because we're always seeking to improve ourselves. We want to be better tomorrow than we were today. We want to improve and do better. God is incapable because he's beyond the need for any improvement whatsoever. Now, this is an important attribute of God, and it's something that we have to not only understand and accept, and men don't like it. That's one of the attributes of God. You know, they certainly love to talk about the fact that God is love. They love the fact that God is merciful. And, you know, they should. Those are wonderful, vital truths. We've preached about those at other times. But for some reason, men, they don't like to hear about the fact of God's holiness. They kind of equate that because they think in such human categories that they think, oh, holy, that means, well, he's unapproachable then. God is maybe proud or aloof to mankind. They would call to mind such things as like the whole burning bush situation where Moses was there and God said to him, Moses, you know, take your shoes off your feet and draw not nigh hither because the place whereon thou standest is holy ground. Moses, you're entering into sacred precincts. I am here. You better get down and you better hold back. And, you know, that kind of rubs human nature the wrong way. But, you know, to be honest with you, if you think about that, God in his holiness is more than that. And in his love, what we see, he is for Moses' benefit and sake. He says, draw not nigh hither. And he has to tell the truth. But do you see how that God himself is drawn near to Moses? God is actually calling out Moses' name. He's saying, Moses, Moses. He's grabbing his attention. He's beginning the process of making a revelation of himself to not just Moses, but really to posterity. He's getting ready to announce a new name that he can be called by, Jehovah. He's getting ready to say, I'm well aware, Moses, of the needs of your people. So he is not an aloof God. You know, you can think about what God's holiness, what it necessarily implies and what it doesn't. I know that the holy city, New Jerusalem, it is such a perfectly holy place that, like God, nothing that is sinful can enter into it. And yet, I, as a sinner, once washed in the blood of Jesus Christ, I can enter into it. I can not only enter into it, there to worship and to be with God, God dwelling with me and I with him, but he has gone there to prepare a place for me. And that gives us to understand that the holiness that God has in his own person, as real as it is something that he wishes to impart to us. He wants us to become, at least at a lower level, partakers of his holiness. And this is a wonderful thing. Tozer says this. He says, God's holiness is not simply the very best that we know, infinitely bettered. No, we know nothing like the divine holiness. It stands apart, unique, unapproachable, incomprehensible, and unattainable. The natural man is blind to it. He may fear God's power or admire his wisdom, but his holiness he cannot even imagine. You know what Tozer said? It's true. That is true about God's holiness. And yet, what do we see in the person of Jesus Christ? That God, despite his great holiness, in a sense, he has become approachable to man. That because he has chosen to. There's other attributes in God other than just the fact of his holiness. He's such a loving being that at one moment we see him, you know, he's saying to the women after his resurrection, there's a post-resurrection period appearance there. And he says, and I think it's in John's gospel, touch me not, for I am not yet ascended up to my Father. And yet if we go back and read in one of the synoptics, I think it may be Matthew, we find that women there are holding him by the feet. And it's because the Lord Jesus, yes, he is holy, but he is also loving. And you know, God's holiness implies some other things too. God's holiness includes the ideas of health and beauty. Now this is interesting, and I'm gonna throw both of those words out there, health and beauty. Now you think about those two things as a value, and you all of a sudden, this should get the attention of people in our society today. Because if there's anything people seem to be genuinely interested in, what they would covet and want for themselves, they would want to have health, would they not? They would want to have beauty. Now, I'm going to connect both of those two ideas, health and beauty, to the holiness of God. First of all, our very English word holy, it derives from an Anglo-Saxon word, hallig. And that word hallig, basically, it carried the meaning of well-being or wholeness, right? The words hail, you remember that word? I know we don't use it much, but you might describe somebody as being hearty and hail. Well, that's related to this word hallig. It's related to the word holy. So also is the word wholesomeness or even heal. Heal is related grammatically to the word holy. They come from the same root. We read here that God is holy and he has made holiness the moral condition necessary to the health of his universe. Sin's temporal presence in the world only accents this. Whatever is holy is healthy. Evil is a moral sickness which must ultimately end in death. And so we understand right away that when we're talking about holiness in God, this is an indication in him of absolute health. He's eternal life that can never be extinguished, but also beauty. And here's the same thing. I mean, because the Bible repeatedly connects the ideas of holiness and beauty together. It says, for one, you know, David, I think it's in one of the Psalms there, he says, "One thing have I desired of the Lord, and that I will seek after, that I may dwell in the house of the Lord all the days of my life, to behold the beauty of the Lord, to inquire in his temple." You know what those beasts and those 24 elders had as a living reality up there in the presence of God? David, he's saying, you know what? That's for me. I want to be in the temple of the Lord. I want to behold his beauty, his glory, his holiness of his being. And to him, that was a destiny. And we are called. We're called to praise the beauty of holiness. We're called to worship in the beauty of holiness. Now, you know, Lucifer was made a very beautiful angel. Lucifer, we read in, I think it's Ezekiel chapter 28. It is. It's Ezekiel chapter 28. That was partly because of his great beauty. He was perfect in beauty. And it became a thing of pride to him because he began to desire an equality with God to, you know, to be receive worship as God received it. And of course, he fell. And he may still be able to appear as an angel of light. And yet, if you were to see him for what he really is now in his true character, sin makes ugly. If holiness lends itself to beauty and to health and to life and to all good things such as men would desire, sin brings the very opposite. The wages of sin, it's deformity, it's death. It is to be not just separated from God in his person, but from his life and his spirit and his grace and everything which through impartation makes life worth living. That's the thing. I tell you what, people, millions of dollars, billions maybe, are spent on what they call health and beauty products. When you stop and you think about the different kinds of things that are spent at spas or gyms or salons or tanning salons, you know, hair salons, cosmetics, surgeries, all these kinds of things, that as people, they're looking in the wrong place for beauty because they think that it's so important, or what is spent on health care. I mean, it's huge. And even today, we're seeing the extent to which people will go in order to preserve their health because it's so important and it ought to be. But you know what? Ultimately, and when we stand before the Lord, and all of us must stand before the Lord, we're going to find out that it is holiness that most of all equates to both health and beauty. Maybe not, you know, there's things that can be said in the temporal realm where it doesn't always line up perfectly. But if you believe the Bible, you know that ultimately where it ends in the presence of God, those who stand in his company, observing his holiness and being partakers of it, they have the health and the beauty of an angel. And that's something to observe. Also, God's holiness, it manifests itself in a glorious presence. Matter of fact, I think that we could say that God's glory, you know, his Shekinah glory, that actually when the priests would see it, it would fill the tabernacle or the temple, and they would be driven back. What is that glory? You say, well, it's an intense, blinding light. It was something that all of a sudden, because of its intensity, they had to leave the presence of God. I'm going to say that that glory, it's an outward manifestation of his inward holiness. His holiness is the reason why outwardly his glory shines with the brightness that it does. And so what we find, like even in this chapter that we just read, is that the closer you get to God, the more powerful an impression God in his holiness, in his perfections, in his power will make on a person. Let me read another thing here by A.W. Tozier, because I really think that there is a sense in which, even though God is far away from us in the third heaven, his spirit all pervades, is omnipresent throughout all creation. And there is a sense in which men, even now in their present state, they can know something and feel something of God. And Tozer kind of brings this out a bit. He writes, in his penetrating study of the holy, Rudolf Otto makes a strong case for the presence in the human mind of something that he names the numinous, by which apparently he means a sense that there is in the world a vague, incomprehensible something, the mysterium tremendum, the awesome mystery surrounding and enfolding the universe. This is an it, an awful thing, and can never be intellectually conceived, only sensed and felt in the depths of the human spirit. It remains a permanent religious instinct, a feeling for that unnamed, undiscoverable presence that runs quicksilver-like through creation's veins and sometimes stuns the mind by confronting it with supernatural and suprarational manifestations of itself. The man thus confronted is brought down and overwhelmed and can only tremble and be silent. He is talking about what I think stands in back of all religions. And, there is a universal impulse within all societies, all men that have ever lived, no matter where, no matter when, they've been driven to worship the invisible God, to know that he is there. And even the most base animistic kind of religions, they have this sense that there is out there a presence and a reality that men are answerable to. And if even in this kind of isolated state where God is so far off, there is enough holiness within him that an impression could be made on our souls. Can you imagine what it'd be like to literally stand in the physical proximity of that awesome Lord God? Just like those beasts and the 24 elders, they stood there and they saw him. And what would that be like for a mere mortal man? And if you'll turn to Isaiah chapter 6, I want to show you that actually happened to a mortal man. John, of course, in the book of Revelation, he saw things that were incredible. Daniel, too, we read sometimes he had some Christophany, so some appearances of the divine that made him powerless and put him flat on his face. But what I want to read to you in Isaiah chapter 6 matches almost, well, very closely what we read there in Revelation chapter 4. And I want you to notice that there was a man, and I want you to notice that man's reaction as he was able to encounter spiritually that presence. So there in Isaiah 6, look at verse 1. It says, in the year that King Uzziah died, I also saw the Lord sitting upon a throne, high and lifted up. His train filled the temple, and above it stood the seraphims. Each one had six wings, and with twain he covered his face. God's holiness was such that, even these holy seraphs, these holy angelic creatures, couldn't look directly upon him. They covered their faces with their wings. Also with two, they covered their feet, and with two, they did fly, and they cried one to another, and they said, here you have it again, holy, holy, holy is the Lord of hosts. The whole earth is filled with his glory. And there, once again, you see perfectly that the idea of God's glory going out and filling the earth, it's connected with this notion that his holiness, his threefold holiness is so perfect. And this brings us to something, because as you continue to read, I want to show you something. It says in verse 4 there, it says, and the post of the door moved at the voice of him that cried, and the house was filled with smoke. And then I said, Isaiah speaks here, he says, woe is me, For I am undone because I am a man of unclean lips, and I dwell in the midst of a people of unclean lips, and mine eyes have seen the King, the Lord of hosts. Actually, Isaiah was a righteous man. He was an anointed prophet. I wouldn't want to stand beside Isaiah to compare personal holiness. He was a man, I think, that would stand a cut above the average people that we meet, know, and associate with. But that amounted to nothing. When all of a sudden he got in company with the Lord of hosts, he said, I'm undone. He said, woe is me. You know, Job had the same reaction when he saw the Lord too. Job, he no longer was protesting his innocence. He no longer was questioning why the evil that befell him happened. Rather than having any further word of, you know, self-defense, he says, I abhor myself. He says, now I've seen you, and I've seen you, and that changes how I see me. Because I've seen you and I see your holiness, I see me differently. I'm forced to abhor myself. I repent in dust and ashes. It's almost as like suddenly Job was able to take, he had no wings, but he could have put his hands across his face because he saw the holiness of God. You know, even when Christ was on earth, you know, the holiness of God was muted because he was in the form of human flesh. But sometimes it would break through with such an astonishing power. Like, you know, when Peter was out there fishing and Christ said, hey, Peter, go out a little further. You're going to cast a net over there and you're going to find. You know, Peter was a professional fisherman. He thought a lot more than Christ about how to catch fish. But hey, you know, he was the rabbi, he's the master. He said, okay, yeah, sure, whatever you want. You want me to go a little further out? I'll do it just for you. And he went out there and he was astonished because they began to fill two boats with what was coming up, and the boats began to sink. And when Peter, the commercial fisherman, he saw it, and he realized there's this calm, sedate man that's sitting there that had been preaching these words, these tremendous words that had stirred his heart, that had brought a summon to multitude. And now he's realizing he's got this power, and he falls down on his knees in front of the Lord Jesus Christ. And he says, depart from me, for I am a sinful man, O Lord. Now, listen, someday, every one of us, every human soul must face its maker. I don't know, it could be at the judgment seat of Christ. It could be at the great white throne judgment. But what really matters is that no man made, no woman made in this world can escape an encounter with God Almighty, in the which they give an account to him. And this brings me to my final point here this morning, and I believe probably the most important point. You know, if there was a place where God intentionally and purposely manifested his holiness for the benefit of the human race so that we could see it, so that we could get it, so that we could know that his holiness was real, it was something to be reckoned on, it governed his behavior and necessarily had to, where can we as human beings look and say, aha, the holiness of God is real and it is to be taken into account? I'll tell you exactly where we would look. We look to Calvary. We look because there at the cross, more than any place else, we see the holiness of God manifested vividly. As a matter of fact, if you will please turn to Psalms 22. Psalms 22 is a famous psalm. You know it as the Psalm of the Cross, because we have set here in this psalm so very, very clearly the prophecy of Christ as he was to come and die, giving his life on Calvary. As a matter of fact, if you look at the very first verse of Psalm 22, this is what you read. You read the words prophetically given back by David all the way in Psalms 22, but they show up in the lips of Jesus Christ as he hung there on the darkness of Golgotha. He said, my God, why hast thou forsaken me? Well, that's a good question. We read that Christ, he uttered that. That's a prayer. coming up out of his burdened soul. The cup of our sin had been drunken in the Garden of Gethsemane. The bitter dregs of it had been taken down. Now that darkness that covered the earth, it rolled in. It veiled the Creator as he hung on the cross before the eyes of God and hidden from the eyes of men. He was suffering for us. And we say, well, why did that have to happen? This is like the most major thing that has happened in the course of human history, that he who made man, he who breathed into man's nostrils the breath of life, he who took the rib from man and fashioned a woman for man and commanded him, you know, suddenly this veil safe zone being is dying on the cross, and he says, my God, why hast thou forsaken me? And you know, the answer is given just two verses later. If you look at Psalms 22, verse 3, but thou art holy. Thou art holy, O thou that inhabitest the praises of Israel. You know, God being holy must punish sin. Nowhere else, I don't think, as the holiness of God demonstrated quite the way that we see it here when we approach Calvary in our understanding. God is loving. He is merciful. God is good and desires to do that which is good. You know, he can be wrathful against that which would destroy the health and the beauty of his creation, which sin does. When he sees the health and the beauty of his creation, of his universe that he made, destroying it, he cannot but act with a holy ardor to come in with judgments to preserve that good which he has made. And so there is a place for wrath. But you know what? In the middle of his wrath, God remembers mercy. And so we see Jesus Christ, because right there on the cross, yes, it was the holiness of God that was revealed. Holiness where God says, you know what? The only way that I can remove your sin, Adam, and all and that of your posterity, is to bear it away myself, to suffer its curse, to suffer its consequence, to take the punishment that could be yours and ought to be yours and absorb it into my own holy being, because I can rise up from the dead having paid and atoned for all of your wrongdoing, and I can offer you the gift of eternal life. So what else do we see manifested? Calvary, that's the place to go to see all the important things of God manifested. We see his holiness there. We see his love there. We see his wisdom there. We see his sovereignty there. We see all these things at Calvary more than what we see them any place else. Now, people, I tell you what, the only way you're ever going to be ready to face this all-holy Lord God is through the shed blood of Jesus Christ. You know, Jesus Christ can take away the filthy rags of our self-righteousness, because our self-righteousness, I realize that there are people that are, you know, more righteous than others. We can look at things comparatively, and that's what men do. That's the human way of looking at things. We just start comparing ourselves amongst ourselves. God looks according to his own nature. He looks down and he says, you all come short. None of you add up to the standard which I live necessarily by. You've all fallen from that. You're a ruined creation and you can't save yourself. But I can save you. That's why Jesus come. You know, he wants to make you and I a partaker of his holiness. So I can walk on streets of gold. You know, the gold in New Jerusalem. Think about this. You know, that gold is so utterly pure that it's transparent. It's like transparent glass, because there's not any kind of impurity in that gold. We don't even have gold like that on earth. There's nothing on earth that pure. I mean, gold so pure that you can see through it because of the utter absence of all impurity. You find that in heaven, because that represents the holiness of God. He is that pure. And you know what? God says, I can give you my holiness as a gift, and you can walk on those golden streets. And You know, but that's only possible as we get into a right relationship with the Lord Jesus Christ. He is holy. And because he's holy, none of us are born into this world in a state where we can assume through our religion, through our connection with parents or anything else, that we can just enter into his presence. It's too dangerous. We cannot. But there is a way. And that way was provided. It is through Jesus Christ who came down. You know, he was that burning bush. But when he came down in the New Testament, it was not in the form of a bush that burned and could not be consumed. It was in the form of a man who gave up his life on a cross and came back up from the dead and came up with power to save you and I if we would but call upon him. And, you know, I would just like to encourage you to think about this because I don't know when he's coming back. It could be soon. It could be later. I know, and I'm at that age now where I think, hey, I might, you know, I don't need to even consider the rapture. I can see him soon enough just by natural means. But when you see him, my friend, when you see him, you want to make sure you see him with his imputed righteousness, his given holiness as your covering. Let's pray. Father, I thank you, Lord, for Jesus Christ. I thank you, Lord, that even though you were holy and in your holiness you were unapproachable, yet in your love and your mercy, you became ultimately approachable. We don't know anyone more approachable than our Lord Jesus Christ. I think of the Apostle John there at the Last Supper, actually lying and reclining so that his head lay upon the bosom of the Lord Jesus Christ. And I suppose if he'd have put his ear just so, he might have been able to hear the heartbeat of the one who sat there, who came into our world and did so to shed his blood to make an atonement for our souls. Lord, it is serious. And we thank you, Lord, that you did manifest yourself as you did. I pray that you would take this message and bless it to the hearts of all those, Lord, who were able to hear. And we'll give you the thanks and the praise for what you do with it, because it is in your name that we ask these things. Amen.